prepare the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Any additions or anything to the agenda?
No.
Looking for...
No.
No.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion and second to approve the agenda as is. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Approve the minutes for the November 11, 2017 regular meeting.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
This motion and second to approve the 11/17/2015 minutes. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, same sign. Motion passes. Public comment? Appears we have none. Move on to Donna.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Well, today I have, I'm presenting my emergency operations plan. We have updated it once this year, but we have, I think there were 8 areas where we could improve upon. So I added, one area was utilities restoration, so I added a standard operating guide, which starts on page 69 of the emergency operations plan. We added that, which is new, and then some other minor updates throughout the plan. And we updated that this year because we will be having an exercise in December yet this year, and then June of next year, which we'll be able to test that. And it's, throughout the plan, you'll notice that the areas are in bold that were changed. So you'll be able to find those a little bit easier. So the plan was emailed to you. I don't have copies printed for you. I ordered more toner. It's not here yet. But I will have a printed copy for each of you before the 16th. So you'll be able to have that, or I'll bring it that evening. Did you have any questions about the updates? Really nothing major except the utilities restoration, and that's dealing more with the critical infrastructure, key resources. So if no questions or concerns, I just ask that you would approve the plan again.
Move to approve the emergency operations plan.
I'll second.
Got a motion and second to approve that plan. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
Thank you. I'll have the chair sign.
All right. What was that, 16th meeting, man? Just ask.
Yes.
Just for the chair.
Oh, here's a, I'm sure you all did see the invitation, but I guess I never even thought about having a special meeting notice, Becky, for that night.
Yeah.
All the members and...
We can, we'll do that at the end here. We'll set 5:30, right?
Five
is registration.
Yes. I'll
add it here.
Thank you.
Five. Yeah. Here, right?
It will be in Hancock at the school.
Just put it in the calendar. I just accepted it. I don't look at it until it's
okay. And then I just had a couple other minor things. Just wanted to let you know, for 2016, our goals, I'll be working on our at-risk special populations work group. We've met with them one time. We're going to pull them back together and finish that annex before the June exercise. We did pull together our EOC team, and we're looking at who really should be in the EOC, so we're redefining that again. We're going to pull in more city workers so that each city can be more involved with their limited numbers, and looking at who from the county should be involved, because we'll be doing other things. We're going to pull together our critical infrastructure key resource team again. We haven't met for over a year now to look at our critical infrastructure. And then for our emergency operations plan updates will be mass care and damage assessments. And then next year, it's the county board who will review the EOP, emergency operations plan. So we'll ask you to all look through that. And then just our exercises from our past after action court improvement plans. It's been evacuation reentry. We're going to work on that again this year or this next year. Resource management, ICS training for everyone, and then working on IFAS. We'll have Homeland Security here on December 15th, the day before our exercise, to review the plan again and help me plan for the 16th. And then we'll have the tabletop exercise in Hancock at the school, and that involves all counties, or all cities in the county. So it should be good. Our involvement is going to be good. So, and hopefully we'll identify areas where we need to improve before June of next year.
That's
all I had.
All right.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you.
I'll probably email you about the meeting
notice.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Okay. Yep, thanks.
Todd.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. Good morning, buddy. Yeah.
Yep.
Last year at this meeting, a little later in the day, so it's kind of nice to be one of the first ones. Well, a lot has changed here since I wrote this up here last week. All the plow equipment is obviously ready to go, and it's been being used today.
Tested yesterday.
Yep. So, yeah, and our guys started at 4 this morning, or earlier. I believe they were out about 2:30, and did some of the cities, and they're going to make one more round on the pavements. And look, they're actually, the roads are looking pretty good.
Yep.
The warm weather's helping. Other than that, our maintenance guys have been out cutting trees and brush that protrudes out into the right way. Pretty much anything that's going to hit our mower tractors, anything that's hanging out there. And so they've been working on that, and they'll be going back to that hopefully. We'll get some nice weather here because there's still quite a bit of brush that needs to be trimmed back. Motor graders been blading roads. That's probably done unless we get some good weather here. County State Aid wanted the new construction. They rolled that in with the roller, and that was my dollar this year today. And it looked pretty good. We did take delivery of that John Deere 770G motor grader on the 19th. And Dan Dostal is our RDO salesman, and he wanted us to get a hold of that thing, get a hold of it so that we could get it all our equipment onto it and get used to it before we had to take it out for snow removal, which we did today. So what Dan has worked out for us is November 19th, we took possession of it. There's no billing for 30 days through RDO, so we won't get a bill until the 19th. There will be 15 days until the first rental. It'll be listed as a rental until the first of the year until we purchase it. But before the first rental payment is due, he's going to switch it over to a sale and we'll make payment on it. So he has this worked out for us so that it's not going to cost us any money. Take possession of it on the 19th, so that was pretty good of Dan to work that out for us. The 19th board meeting, we'll bring that to the board meeting for approval of payment, and the 22nd, the check we get mailed out to RDO. So that's how that's going to work in the motor grader. On the engineering side, our greening base, Casaw 1, north of Hancock, is complete. Earl Early was down and gave it his inspection, and just got a hold of that approval in the mail today, so that's officially finaled out. Merle's incidentally retiring here this year, and I think today might have been his last day. He's being replaced by Nathan Gannon. Nathan Gannon is the assistant engineer of Clay County, or Cass County, Minnesota, and I think Nathan is going to be a very good fit for that position.
I was on County Road 1 the other day. Nice road. It's going to be really nice when
you're
done.
Yeah.
Really. You didn't have to go up in that guy's yard so much as I thought you were going to have to.
Nope.
That turned out really nice. Yep. A lot of big worry about that you're going to really get up in his yard.
Up in the wall.
Yeah. Lays in there really nice.
And we had that big wind a couple weeks ago, and the the water up on the road and pump it. So yeah, it's turned out pretty well. It's hard to picture how close to the water that road was.
Yes. You did a good job.
Yeah.
So Todd, they'll get final payment, the authorization from Riley Brothers on it, or has that already been done?
No, we're working on that, yeah. Yep, that might actually be over at Riley Brothers right now. I know Len was working on it. I'm just gonna get that over to him so that we can get that final payment done. Annual bridge inspections we did last week, Monday and Tuesday. Ryan Anderson came down from Otter Tail County. He possesses the NBI team leader certification, which is necessary. So we did 16 bridges and they will bill us for hours of mileage for that. Several miscellaneous fall surveys that you guys are still working on, some stockpiles. Scott Erickson is our new GIS technician, began work on November 10th, and he's been doing some inspecting ditch cleanup projects, assisted with surveys, and he's working on the GIS landscape map. He's doing very well with that. He's having no problem with any of the GIS work. So. In addition to that, I guess we're working on the bituminous paving plan for next summer. We're going to try to get that sent in December so that we get that back about the first of the year, sometime in January, get moving on that. And the County Road 70 bridge plan, we're going to have to get a core permit going on that. So it's down the road a ways, but got to get going on it right away. Our Bowser regional guy is going to come and take a look at that bridge sometime here in December.
That's set for next year, right?
That's for 17.
Oh, 17.
Yeah, 2017.
Okay.
Yeah, but because of all the permits, can't start too early on. Yeah, we found that out on our County Road 1 project. It was kind of a rush to get our MECA permit. For the administrative side, I guess we're planning on that Jackson County Highway Department. We're going to go tour that Thursday. Of course, that's that one of the Minnesota County Engineers Association project of the year, so it's a very impressive shop. Hopefully we get some ideas from it. The county ditch side, Mike Berlinger was actually, he came in today, and he caught 6 beaver from 5 locations. And so we're going to take a track hoe in. We're going to have to get a contractor to remove 2 of those dams because ours doesn't reach far enough in there. We'll get those dams ripped out, and hopefully that's the end of our beaver problems in those 5 spots. Now, the ditch cleaning project on County Ditch 1 and on JD2. Both complete. JD2, I think he worked a little bit on Thanksgiving Day and got that one done. So they're all finished. One addition to the County Ditch 1, and I did talk to Ron a little bit about that. At a request of a landowner, Derek Huebner, we went an extra 3,600 feet on that, up to the point where it had been clean previously. Because I guess there was a little section in there where there was a hump and some vegetation that needed some additional cleaning. So the total length for that project was 7,249 feet. Having a contractor in there at $1.25 a foot, I don't think we could have gotten it down any cheaper, you know, at any time. So we went ahead and did that. I don't know if we need additional approval for that or not.
Anyway, for the extra footage?
Yeah, for the extra footage that was added on.
Probably not.
I wanted to bring it to your attention there. One other item, I guess, is the county engineer's screening board on October 29th approved a new system to calculate the county needs for 2016. And that was one of them that Brian Geese had been working on for several years, I think all the way back to like 2005 that he was working on this. So it's got 8 criteria, and that will be our new system for calculating the needs of our state aid systems.
So this is for funding?
Yeah.
Yep.
That will be good. We've been frozen for several years.
Okay.
And that's, I guess, all I have.
What time did it go off this morning and start plowing?
4:30. Yeah, Mike called the guys. Mike ended up, I don't think he even went to sleep last night. He said he was laying in bed, and at 1 o'clock he just got up and he went out and called the blades to do the cities at 2:30. And then the rest of the guys he called at 4:30, so, or 4. Yeah, kind of a short night for them. But
it's the
part of the
weather really helped, so.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep, it did, and what was left on the roads was, so about 12, 1 o'clock, they decided to run the blacktops one more time, just to get that off. We might need to run the blacktops.
Yep. Some of them did, not all of them.
Yep, maybe after they do one more time tomorrow and sand some intersections and warm weather, we should be good.
It's supposed to be 40s.
Yep.
Okay, thank you very much.
Good night.
Thank you.
You're in the office update, you could start with Aaron Jordan.
What are you laughing at?
I didn't.
Tell a good joke when you start.
What's that?
From my old ones.
No, okay, I'm gonna keep you waiting.
I want to take a degree.
It's good to start with a good joke.
All I do is take. Can I borrow your mouse?
Yep, this too?
Thank you.
You're not gonna let me do anything, huh?
Thank you. I started this presentation months in advance this year, and I went out on Phil's Lake Hattie property and took this picture.
I'm sure you did.
Or I got it off the internet.
Tractor, comment.
I set this off at.
Was that those answers?
Yeah, this is the answers.
I sent you an email.
What's that? Oh, sure.
You're so prepared.
So, let me find my standing spot here. Well, this picture here, I originally started off with something different here, and then I erased it because I didn't think it would add to the conversation, but I still like the picture. Because I sat there and I scratched my head, I thought, so how do you actually enforce this?
It's an ordinance.
Well, I mean, presumably the guy has jumped off the bridge. Whoever has this enforced, I don't know.
If you have to go fish him out.
Yeah. I don't know, maybe it's standing over a bridge that has water underneath it, hopefully. But I wanted to, I know this kind of gets to be like Christmas service every year where you go in and you get to hear the same story, it's the birth of Jesus and that kind of thing. But I think it's important each year that we do have this conversation, even though it's kind of the same each year. And what is the relationship between my office and the board? And I think it's good to hear that every year, what it is. You guys are checks and balance on my office. You're not my boss, I'm not your boss, I don't tell you what to do, but you guys serve a very important function in not only my office, but the other elected offices, just like the legislature with the governor's office. You act as a check on me, I act as a check on you, and you set my budget, you set the salary, and you represent the people of the county, keeping my office accountable. And that's important. You know. My bosses are the 10,000 people that live here and every registered voter in the county. But I'm also accountable to you, and you are the mechanism for doing that. What we do, I try to abbreviate the best I could what we do. Mostly I prosecute crimes. That's what I do. 70% of what I do is prosecuting crimes. And I give legal advice. I review contracts. I wanted to show you, I really wanted to show you something, a video that I get, you know, I get all these squad cam videos all year round, and I get video from police cameras and that kind of thing. I wanted to show you something that actually happens in my office, and I had a really good one, and I wanted to show it to you, but I can't do it because it's just a little too risky. So instead, I wanted to show you something a little bit different. it's not from my actual practice, it's something I found that...
I had to turn the volume.
Okay.
Sorry. Exit full screen.
Is it on though?
Nope, you had to turn it on down here. See it? There you go. All right. Yeah, just turn, okay, go there now. I have my mouse, I can do it. Okay, there, just click that little red thing. There you go.
There you go.
Sorry.
So this is an example of my negotiating. I have to go negotiate my cases every day. When you see me walking down the hallway and I'm meeting with other attorneys, I have to negotiate. So this video, I think, kind of summarizes my practice of negotiating and also my love of fantasy football.
And we have what I believe is enough evidence to put you away for 10 years.
No. Ernie's an innocent man, so he's not going away for any time. Ernie, did you do it?
Of course not.
There you go. Really? Ernie, do you remember waving at the surveillance cameras of all three liquor stores? We've got the videotape.
Actually, I have one like that this year.
Hi, Mom! It's me, Ernesto! Your client's going away for 10 years. Unless... Let's swap first round picks. Sidebar. You can't take me the one pick. You give me the number one pick. I'm gonna give you my sixth pick in the draft, okay? And I'm gonna give your client 7 years. I'm gonna knock it down from 10 to 7. For the number one pick.
I gotta skip here because it gets a little Jeannie would be mad if she heard that.
Sir, thank you. Listen to me, I'm doing you a favor here, okay? This is pro bono work for you.
Listen, all I want to say to you is this. I got to do two of these cases a year. This man, guilty or innocent, can do no more than 6 years for third round picks.
It's not going to happen, okay? It's first round pick. What do you want to do?
He goes for 5 years, we swap first rounds. I should do any business with you, sir. What was that?
You're going away for 5 years, and I just lost Adrian Peterson. You have to go to the third liquor store? Just go to one. I stole a Kit Kat last week. Nobody knows. You keep it small.
So... I'm telling you, I've got some strange things when I get in those negotiation rooms, and well, that's not quite the truth. I've had some doozies over the years, and it can get a little interesting. So these are my these probably look familiar to you. I ran these are my qualifications. I have to tell you these because the statute says you have to evaluate what my qualifications are. So this is a little summary of what I do. Of what my background is. This is my experience. It's changed a little bit. This year we had, our office had 5 jury trials. I had 3 of them, Carl handled 2 of them. So those numbers went up. We had a lot of court trials. I don't really know how many, but that number's probably a little bit old. These numbers here are our new files each year. Our total office files, we opened 377 in 2014. And what I'm gonna do from now on is, instead of giving you from a certain month to a certain month in any given year, I'm gonna wait till the end of the year to give you my numbers. So in January, February, March, I'm gonna give you my 2015 numbers. And I'm gonna keep doing that year after year instead of giving you from September of last year to September of this year. That way we can kind of keep it consistent. My numbers are probably similar to last year. Our biggest thing has been crim sex cases. Starting late last year into the summer, we had one come in per month, which is very unusual for us. We've had a lot of them, and it's been busiest period in my time here for that type of case, and hopefully we're seeing the tail end of that now. These are statistics for most of the human services stuff. Carl handles most of the human services stuff. Child protection, delinquencies, commitments, that sort of thing. We're getting a lot of reports now on vulnerable adults and abuse of vulnerable adults. I've seen more of that this past year than I had previously, and I think with the emphasis that the media is putting on this, and it is a problem, I think we're going to see more and more of these types of cases. This talks a little bit about our how many hearings that we went to, and I use this term, sweet righteous justice, because there's a very good attorney, Pete Orpitt, Washington County attorney. He's the guy who prosecuted the case in, up in Morrison County, the guy who had, the kids had broken into his home and shot him,
yeah.
Yeah. He's a very charismatic speaker, Pete is. He's a very good guy. And Carl was at a seminar earlier this year where Pete was speaking, and he made a very good point. What do we do here? You know, what is it that we, you know, you can say, I go in the field and I harvest, and then I go and I sell my product. You fix cars, and you're, working days, you were a concrete person that you could see what you had done. You help people in your therapy practice, and you can see the results. I don't get that luxury. I don't get to see the good things that happen because of my work a lot of time. You know, we go into court, we have our hearings, and then people go on their way. Either they go back to their lives, they're on probation, they go to prison. Every once in a great while, we'll have somebody come back and say, look, this experience, this program I went to, this prison experience changed me for the better, but it's rare. So what do we do to make ourselves, to tell ourselves what it is that we're doing? And we have to tell ourselves we're selling justice. We are presenting ourselves to the public and saying, this is what we do to make sure that behaviors change and that laws are followed. And regardless of what the outcome is on each case, the fact that we're going through and working the cases hard and making sure that from our part that the law is being abided by, we're selling that concept to the public. So while it may sound a little silly, I think it's got a very powerful meaning behind it. This is more a little bit about the performance, the things that I do. I pick this picture because some days I do feel like I'm a little bit of a lion tamer. I have to juggle all these different things that I do and kind of keep everything in order. And as you can see, there's several different things that I have to attend to in a week, any given week. This guy's got very nice teeth, very big teeth. Some of the things that we do, other than just serving our county, we provide assistance to other counties, and we end up doing that a little bit more than our surrounding neighbors do because, well, we do have one more attorney in the office, so Grant and Big Stone and Pope, we end up serving those counties a lot because we can, and we don't send as much work their way because we don't have the conflicts that they do because we are a full-time office. So while they send us quite a bit of stuff, what we send them in return in any given year usually isn't as much. That's not true every single year. I can think of one year where that might have been probably 2014, that might not have been true, but in most years we take more work from other counties than we get back. So, if you have any questions about budget and salary, I want to reserve this time for that. I made some notes in my answers to the questions that you had asked made some notes about different things regarding my salary. So if you had any questions for me about that.
The one thing I was going to visit with about is, you know, the strategic goals and performance measures that you set for yourself and your department in 2016. And what I was kind of thinking about there is in terms of like a lean process, the one thing that came to mind is like your e-filing system. You guys are going to have to implement that in 16, is that correct?
Yep, that's right.
So I think like that is a good process that, you know, you could use for your example there. Because I asked all the other department heads, find one thing that you could save time, money, people, or that's going to streamline a process. And that has yet to be seen whether it's going to streamline.
Yeah, I may have mentioned of it, but yeah, I don't, all the e-filing and e-discovery, the overall system will realize savings, but will our office realize savings? Probably not. They're shifting the burden, is what they're really doing. What used to be done by court administration, where we took physical papers over and gave it to them, and then they input it in the system, we do all that up front now. So all the codes that they use to track everything that we do for statewide statistical purposes, we do that now, not them. And that doesn't save us anything. And it's the same with the e-filing and e-discovery. It saves court time because they don't have to actually put a physical piece of paper in a physical file. And it's a good thing. It saves trees, and it's, but for us, it doesn't save us time, it doesn't save us money.
Well, maybe you can just report back to us and let us know that goals. Because I, you know, I know you had talked about it's going to be kind of challenging because it's required. Correct?
It's not required.
They're not giving you an option. So it'd be kind of nice to see how that does affect, you know, because you're going to have to, you have to do it. So it'd be nice to see what that impact is.
Yeah.
I don't know, your contracts with the other cities, how's that working? I mean, City of Morris, is that the dollars? Is that comparable to the time you're putting in and stuff?
I think so. It's going pretty well. Right now, I think we're at $39,000 a year for the City of Morris contract. And, you know, what they pay for, you know, statutorily, I have to do their felonies no matter what. So what they're paying for is their misdemeanors and their civil work. And so I think $39,000 a year is probably pretty fair. And most years, I'm trying to get it on an every other year basis where I go to them and I say, you know, let's look at increasing this. And so far when I've made the request, they've granted it. So that's been good.
So do we have a two-year contract, one-year contract?
We have, now that, what I did with all the cities, starting with this year, is we're on four-year contracts. And what it does is it follows my term of election so that all the cities are contracted for the time that I'm in office. And so it's the same with all the cities. And the city work for the other towns, kind of, it varies depending on whether or not they have a project going or not. Now, this year I spent a sizable amount of time working with Chicago because they had some EDA things that needed to be handled, but that's not going to be every year. And some years it's been the Hancock's needed us for different things. We had one year where Alberta wanted to do stuff with their dog ordinance, so it's, you know, it depends on the year and the need, but all the other towns are, Albany, Morris is a flat fee. Any other questions?
I appreciate the feedback for questions.
Yes.
Thank you.
Good work.
Well, I had just one more.
Oh, you got here. One?
This is for Phil.
Thank you.
A good start.
There you go.
And one more.
Close. Maybe soon. Uh-oh.
Three.
That's all I have.
Appreciate that. Very good. Jason, you got a tough act to follow.
I just want to say I appreciate you coming before us as a public or elected official. because you don't have to.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity. You know, I know in some counties, and I know previous to me, that they maybe didn't want to for certain reasons, but the statute says you have these things that you need to evaluate every year, your spending budget and salary, and I don't know how else you do it unless we do this. And I think it's worked out. I think every year it gets a little bit easier and a little bit better to do it, and it feels more normal. So thanks for the opportunity.
Thanks for all the information.
Yep,
thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Can I get my stuff back?
You can have your stuff back, huh?
Thank you.
You can have your toys back.
I certainly don't need it.
No, we don't.
Quite frankly, I haven't had time to do a PowerPoint presentation, so.
Thank you, Aaron.
I am missing advice, of course.
You are missing advice.
I don't have a whole lot of information or materials to give you anyway. Generally, I give you guys a year-end statistical report. And that year-end report tends to be early spring before it's actually compiled, so that will be coming. I believe I gave you guys kind of an update on the statistics back in June or July, so it takes a while to compile all of that. We'll be getting another one just to kind of gauge the differences from year to year as far as the different crimes that are reported. So, I guess I don't really have a speech prepared. I'm here to answer any questions you guys have. Otherwise, I can just go through the questions, the highlighted ones we find. Start there and feel free to ask me questions that you have. So, unlike Aaron, I'll probably start at the top here and do the salary and budget right off the top here instead of waiting until the end. So. The question raised is what salary am I requesting in 2016? And it says, please state the amount in dollars. And actually, I can't do that because I don't even know what I make in budget. Dollars. So.
And one thing I was going to say, you know, Aaron had shared some information with me before the meeting on a salary survey that the Minnesota Association of County Attorneys, right? And Jason had shared one with me too, and I think I'll send that with the wage grid and what was budgeted, and you guys can look at that for the 12-16 meeting. I don't know the dollar amount either off the top of the head, but 2% went in the budget on top of everybody's is what went in there above last year. The electeds, you know, the electeds aren't on a salary schedule per se, but they were assigned a grade for a range for recommendations. So I wanted to ask that question in case there were certain considerations that, you know, the electeds wanted you to take under consideration when you set that. And give you some time to think about it before the next board meeting, because we'll set those on the 16th.
There's one thing that I want to bring up just, and I know we've talked about it in the past, just to remind you that Tom Lowe, the chief deputy, is on the grading step system. And he still has 3 steps to go. And I believe a step is 3%.
Yep.
So he has 3 more of those to go. So just, I want you to be cognizant of the fact that we need to try to keep that separation as best we can. That's really all I have to say about the salary budget. So.
Do you want to talk a little bit about, you know, some of the things that you delegate to Tom and that he takes for you?
Yeah, that's kind of a tricky question. It's not like he, I don't delegate a lot of the statutorily required things that the sheriff needs to do. Tom is, and this is something that we're still, you know, Tom's been in there for 2 years now as the chief deputy, and it's still a work in progress simply because we've never really had a chief deputy, an official one prior to this. So it was, the first year was a juggling act as far as figuring out what things he should be doing, what things I should be doing. That's settled down quite a bit lately. But the bottom line is that Tom, as the chief deputy, is a first line supervisor. So the deputies, the dispatchers, they have issues regarding, you know, other employees or policy questions, just general questions on how to handle things. Tom's the first person they go to. And if Tom doesn't know the answer, we talk about it and come up with what the answer should be. So I guess that's the biggest thing that Tom does for me is that he's the first line supervisor. There are other things such as scheduling for both the deputies and the dispatch that Tom oversees the scheduling and dispatch. He actually does the schedule for the deputies. So any vacation requests or schedule adjustments that need to be made, Tom takes care of that. So.
Is it the right process?
I think it is. It's,
I mean, it's instituted now.
Yes.
Working. I mean,
I would not go back to the way we did it before. We like how things are working, and I think we made the absolute right decision. So, there's, with anything new, there's tweaking we need to keep going, but that's part of life. So, the question here is highlight or amplify those duties of your office that I believe the county board should know more about. And what I want to do is turn that question around to you guys, and I would like to know from you what you want to know about our office. I was going to bring in, I have three manuals that would have stacked up about that high, which are all of the statutory duties required of the sheriff. I didn't bring them down simply because I didn't want to carry them that far, too big. There's just so many things by statute that the sheriff is responsible for, and I wouldn't even know where to begin. So I want to turn this question around to you guys, and if there are anything specific, just let me know and I'll answer anything that you want. So.
You know, I have a hard time knowing who works in your office. I mean, names of the deputies,
yeah,
and all that, because you don't get to see, I mean, they're always out, they're always,
yeah.
Live where I live.
But I don't speak. I don't speak.
I'm glad you said that.
Or I wouldn't. You know what I mean? I don't think it, you know, it'd be nice to bring one in once in a while. I mean,
yep.
To seem like we just go day after day and everybody's so busy that nobody knows. But,
right.
But I know you have some fine officers and dispatch a great dispatch team. And
we do.
Secretaries.
And I'm going to talk about that a little bit, okay, in the back here. But our new part-timer we hired is working out phenomenally. He's just a perfect kid, and he's catching on really quickly. So,
but when you run into him in public, these people, you like to say hello,
right,
and tell him they're doing a good job,
right,
or whatever. So,
and what is still on my to-do list, I haven't officially brought him down here to have,
yeah,
sworn in. So,
no, you should.
I'm going to do that. And then the investigator position that you guys approved, that closed yesterday at the end of business hours. I was just scoring applications here before this meeting. I'm planning on interviewing on Friday for that position. I think I ended up with 5 applications for that position.
Any internal ones?
There's no internal from our office. There's internal, not internal, but there's local.
Okay.
So, it's going to be good. And one thing I wanted to express to you guys is how appreciative I am of your support on these types of things that I bring to you. It's, I've said it before and I'll say it again, we're all on the same team here. and we're all working for the same goal, and that's to serve our communities. So, thank you.
Jason, I have one question.
Yeah.
Deputy Emergency Manager, what's going to happen there? I think we need to have a plan in place for that, or?
We do. I've been the sheriff now for, it'll be 3 years and a few weeks. And I'll be brutally honest in telling you that the first year and a half or 2 years was spent by me trying to keep my head above water and learning the job and making sure everything was being run properly on a day-to-day basis. Now that I feel more comfortable, I've settled in, I've got a chief deputy now, I have a wonderful staff. I've been able to recently start looking at some strategic planning and some long-term goals, one of which was the criminal investigator. And in that vein, I realized that emergency management needs to be looked at a little bit closer, as far as, we have Donna, who does a wonderful job, but she needs some backup. And I'm still working at the process of getting the certification for it. Although my position as sheriff, if there's an emergency, I'm still going to manage it, whether or not I have a piece of paper saying I went through the courses or not. But with that said, if we have a major catastrophe in this county, we need to have some depth, which we don't have right now. So that's one thing that I'm looking at, and I'm trying to figure out what the best way of going about that would be, whether that would be offering that deputy emergency position to another current staff member, or if it would make sense to, expand a little bit. I don't know, but it's definitely something we're going to have to put on the top of my to-do list and have discussions about that. So.
One more question then.
Yeah.
At our personnel level meetings, there's been some concern about SPS and keeping that individual busy when there's not that duty to do. I guess that's my question. What is there something that we need to do there, or transfer the duties, or something?
That's one of those things where, like a lot of things in this job, it's we have little control over how much crime there is. I mean, we're proactive. We go out there and try to prevent a lot of things. But as far as the STS is concerned, it's hard for her to. She's kind of at the mercy of the court. You guys know that.
Yeah.
And one thing that has helped in some of her downtime is that Human Services is starting to utilize her to do some transports. For certain individuals that don't require law enforcement transport, if it's a client that they have that needs to go to a medical appointment or something like that, rather than taking up the time from a social worker, I've worked with Joni and we're allowing Lisa to do that. But again, that's sporadic. It's nothing scheduled, but that does help use up some of her downtime that she may have. We try to keep her busy doing stuff up in the office that needs to get done, but again, it's something that we need to look at.
And that's one thing, I think too, that I'd like to do a strategic planning process. I mean, it was a busy first year for me too, but involve both the electeds and the department heads and look at how we're utilizing some positions and see if we can assign additional duties, reallocate duties, something like that. Not talking about eliminating positions, I'm talking about using them more effectively and efficiently. And so you know, if you guys are open to that in 16, I'd like to make that a priority during the first quarter of the year. And that, you know, I think that's one thing to discuss and look at the number of hours and stuff. And it, you know, she isn't in control of who commits crimes, but, you know, there's been a decrease in some of the hours in that area too, so.
Another question is, what's the current volume of business and how has it changed over the last year? Kind of along those same lines, it's very difficult to anticipate when crimes are going to be committed. If I could do that, I would be a very lucky man and be very busy. But law enforcement, unfortunately, is kind of a reactive type of business. There are things we can do to be proactive and to deter crime, but a really difficult thing to measure, an almost impossible thing to measure, is deterrence. When we're out patrolling, how do we know that we're deterring a crime? We don't know. But I do know that if we're not out patrolling and making traffic stops and contacting people, that I know crime would be more than what it is now. But to put a number on how many crimes we deter by patrolling, it's impossible.
Are you noticing any trends?
You know, for a while there, it looked like heroin was going to be the next meth epidemic, but as of right now, knock on wood, that hasn't really developed yet. We have seen some of it. We have heard about it in the general region here, but to call it a problem yet here, I don't do that. But like with meth, we could see it coming from the other areas, metro areas, and it hit here. And I just hope that doesn't happen with the heroin.
And you'll bring back those year-end statistics in the first quarter?
Yes.
And Jason and I talked about that. It didn't really make sense, being he had just done a statistic update in like August, isn't it?
July or August.
Yeah. So, you know, we could look at some of that too, but you don't feel like there's any large sticking trend?
I don't.
Yeah.
No. Okay. Things are going good.
I was at a meeting up with some northern counties a couple weeks ago, and they had talked about meth again, just picking up in their country, but it's not locally made meth, it's brought in
meth. Yeah.
And it's a higher or more potent.
Yes, and that's accurate for here too. During the meth craze back in the early 2000s, that was stemming from the local, in the trunk of your car, meth labs. It was low quality meth, but easy to make, easy to get the ingredients to make it. Through legislation, that has gotten better, simply because it's harder to collect the mass quantities of the pseudoephedrine that it takes to make it. So the meth we're seeing now is the higher quality, and it's coming from Mexico and in what they call super labs, where they make, you know, instead of using a Mountain Dew bottle, they use 55-gallon drums. So,
more better.
Yeah, more profit for them. So, meth has certainly not gone away, but it's not crazy like it was in the early 2000s. So, it's still here, and it will probably always be here.
So, on that topic, how has your department responded to drug court, and what do you think are the effects
of the drug court?
Mm-hmm.
To be really honest, I was very hesitant when we started talking about this drug court. I wasn't against it, but I had my doubts. But after seeing how it's helped some of the people that are currently in it, I am 100% in favor of it. And I think it's good. And even if it helps one or two people completely change their lives, like I think it has, it's worth it.
Okay.
because hopefully those one or two people that have changed their lives will tell their story and help others get into the program and change their lives.
Well, and their parents, and it's going to change their kids' lives. Yes,
absolutely. One of the things that I wanted to talk about as far as the lien process that Becky asked for, the thing that I came up with is employee evaluations. We have, not since I've been a part of the sheriff's office, I have never had an employee evaluation when I was a deputy, and I haven't done employee evaluations yet as sheriff. Tom and Lori and I, earlier this summer, went to a class put on by the Minnesota Sheriff's Association, specifically on employee evaluations, and specifically for sheriff's offices. We got a lot of information, a lot of model forms. What we're doing right now, and I understand HR here has all of that stuff, but what we learned at this class through the MSA is that employee evaluations for the sheriff's office need to be more job specific. So what we're currently doing is developing our own process for doing employee evaluations, and it's a work in progress. Our initial goal was to do them before the end of the year, but you know how the end of the year gets, we're getting slammed with trying to figure out everything else here. So our new goal is the first quarter of January to conduct them on all sheriff's office employees. So.
And we've been moving, all the department, we've talked about this, the department meetings, everybody to once a year as opposed to an anniversary date, because it's easier, it's easier to track everybody that way and to ensure everybody's doing it, because there has been inconsistency across the organization that being consistently done.
It's easier administratively to do it.
Yeah.
Once a year.
And, you know, Jason had some things that came up, and I'm fine at the end of the first quarter, and I think that, you know, everybody will be done by then. We set the end of the year, but we're hoping we'll give you a little leeway because you've had some change over in your office. But I think that's important to do on an annual basis, and we talk a little bit, and they certainly are a little bit different than our office staff, so I think that other evaluation fits.
I don't know how I'm doing on time here, so.
Yep. The 10 minutes, 11 minutes, 12 minutes.
All right. Still. Strategic goals and performance measures for 2016. Like I mentioned earlier, I feel more settled in now, and I feel like I can put more time and energy into things that have been put on the back burner for me. And one of them, for me personally, is community engagement. Not just for me, but for my deputies as well. It seems like the first couple of years I was in office here, I couldn't leave the office. It was just, I was being bombarded constantly. And that's hard. It's hard to get out and talk to the community when I'm stuck in the office. Now that it seems like that's lightened up a little bit, my goal is to get out there and go to more public meetings, the Kiwanis and things like that, and engage the public and answer questions that they might have and concerns that they might have. So, and again, not just for me, but I'm going to encourage my deputies to do the same thing. And they're already good at that. They take it upon themselves to go to the school and have lunch with the kids every once in a while and things like that. So, as far as my employees, I can't say enough good things about them. They actually make my job, I don't want to say easy, but they make my job enjoyable. And I want to keep that going. For dispatch, there's a couple, two to three retirements that are, they're not impending, but they're kind of looming on the horizon. And dispatch in the past has always been a hard position to recruit and retain good employees there. So that's another thing strategically that I'm looking at is how am I gonna, when that time comes that I need to replace dispatchers, how am I gonna do that and find the best quality candidate? So again, it's something that's on the horizon. It's not anything, you know, immediate, but something that I definitely need to keep in mind.
So if we took a poll of your employees, would they vote that they enjoy working for you too?
I hope so.
Well,
I think so, yes.
I believe you too. What's important that...
And you know, that's part of the employee evaluation, yes. Is that they have an opportunity to...
Correct.
To express any concerns.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's good. Yep.
And to be quite honest, I don't know why these evaluations have never really been done in our office. I don't know the answer to that, but after going to that training and seeing what the benefits are of it, it's something we have to do. So, and it's to the point too where the employees are asking for this even to be evaluated because they want, you know, they don't want to be just told when they're doing something bad or doing something really good. They want to be able to gauge their performance and how they're doing and
some feedback.
Absolutely. So as far as managing my budget, one thing that I really appreciate is getting the quarterly budget reports. So I can see on black and white where I'm at on each line item. That's helped tremendously. The last one I got, I went through and it looks like I'm right on most line items and I'm under on some. I might be over on a couple, but overall bottom line, I think I'm doing good on the budget. So again, it comes down to not being able to anticipate what happens in the law enforcement world sometimes. So. It's one of those things where I set my budget based on history, what we've used in the past, and I try to think of what might be coming up in the future, and I do my best at it, and so far it's been working out. So. There's a question about compliance. That's something that the Minnesota Post Board is very good about conducting compliance audits. The Post Board is our licensing bureau, I guess. And they audit both individual deputies and offices as a whole. So they audit both on training records and policy management. That's done on an annual basis. So no concerns there. We've never had any issues with being out of compliance.
Jason, you just mentioned training. Have you done any? There's been a lot of news about sex trafficking and mental health calls. Have you done extra training around either one of those?
The sex trafficking, we have people signed up for that. They're offering classes throughout the state on that topic. And we have, I think, three of the four deputies are signed up for that. So, yeah. And that's one of those things that it's... the title of it is kind of deceiving. There's more to it than, you know, it's not just prostitution. There's a whole gamut of things that are involved in that. So.
But it's even how you treat that person from
a
law enforcement's perspective.
Absolutely. Yep.
You know?
Yep. Especially when you're dealing with underage.
Right.
You know, people that are engaged in that, they're not criminals. They're victims in this whole thing. So. Yep. I think I touched on everything that I wanted to bring up. So feel free if you guys have any questions. Otherwise, like I've always said and I will continue to say, if you guys have any questions, please call me or email me, whatever. I want to be transparent with you guys and the public, so let me know. And if you're hearing questions or concerns from the public, direct them to me, and I'll be more than willing to talk to them.
Very good. Any questions?
Anything else? All right.
Thanks for coming by.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Like Aaron said, you have to know my qualifications. I still maintain my inaccuracy PA license. My major in accounting and finance never does go away. I'm now a certified passport acceptance agent, as passports are accepted in our office. I'm qualified to help out my staff on that. And pretty active in the MCATRO organization. Requesting for salary, it's kind of scary to start off with that one, but I just got a COLA, if you guys don't remember, from September.
Well, we remember.
So I didn't really think I had to bring that up, but it was one of those yellow questions. So don't really think it's necessary to that, as I mean, it was just 3 months ago, and then we'll probably, I recommend just taking a look at it at the end of 16 again, and I think it's sufficient in my eyes anyway. Primary office is my duties. Not everyone does know that we do passport acceptance. It's actually a really great location for all those who do apply for first-time passports. If you do need a birth certificate, you can just walk over to the recorder's office, apply right there. They can get it to you in a couple minutes, and then you can come back over and finish your application. So it is a really great location for that, and I know we've got a lot of people that coming in for passports. They actually expect, by they I mean the passport agency in Minneapolis, to have an increase in passports in 2016 and 2017. So we can see an increase of people coming into our office for either renewal questions or for new passport application at the TSA is taking a look at enhanced driver's license. The passport card qualifies for domestic air travel, and it's a great identification card for any females who don't want to have their birth date or address for ID purposes. So we are expecting an increase in applicants in our office. As great as that sounds, it is a time requirement. We figure about a half hour for each one of the applications. And it doesn't sound like a whole lot during the day, but if it's November 15th and we have taxpayers coming in, we've got two terminals for that, and we've got a third person helping out with the passports, it can get to be not so much as a burden, but it can get a little hairy in the office. So we are looking at requiring appointment times during our busy season, not so much to reduce the number of foot traffic, but just to try and make sure that when you do come in to apply for your passport, you have our undivided attention. 15 people aren't coming in to try and pay their taxes, and there isn't a time where we have 5 or 6 different applicants up front with us, and we're only an office of 4, and if somebody is out for lunch, we're now an office of 3. So we are looking into that, but we do those, and everyone on my staff is very educated on that, and they make sure they have their annual training in at the end of the year. Everyone knows we collect property taxes, send out statements. We do the majority of the accounts payable processing, but we do cut all of the checks, and we are responsible for elections, all voter registrations, Unicava, absentee ballots, election judge training we'll be doing here in May and June, and we're the place to file for candidacy for the county and township governmental offices. So we do get hit by that every even year. So we're gearing up for that already now. Deb's making sure I'm fully aware of everything, and she's our elections expert, so we're getting ready. The tax collections has been a topic of concern for quite a few taxpayers, actually. These last couple of years, the mail has been either unreliable or the postmarks aren't mailed the day they put them in the mailbox because they do have to travel to Minneapolis for postmark. We're trying, statutorily, I have to assess a fee for postmarks that are after the due date. And we're seeing a little bit more foot traffic because of that reason. People want to come in, either get a receipt or know that they paid it on time. And there's a couple of different options that we can provide our taxpayers with to help with the postmark issue. I'm looking into getting a drop box in the entryway. We can have that locked, sealed, and then empty, just like Human Services does. And we can make sure that any of those that we get in the office the next morning are considered received the day prior. So that would be an option too, as well as we are working with CPUI to take a look at what we can do for ACH withdrawals. When taxpayers can give us their checking account and we can withdraw on their due date for their taxes, and we could use that avenue rather than having them mail the checks. So we're taking a look and seeing what that would. We do have the technology, what sort of training that it would take, what sort of time, that sort of thing. So there are options that we're looking at to help reduce any of those late fees that are caused by the mail. So we're constantly taking a look at that sort of thing, trying to make it a little bit easier. Some of the improvements that we did this year in my office, the cash register system started right out in January, February. Limited a double entry. The taxpayers like it because we can give them a computerized receipt. We like it because we only need to receive it in once rather than twice. We actually have a separate computer terminal up there to make sure that when during tax payment season is here, we've got two computers for receiving tax payments and an additional one for any cash or flat book purchases, that sort of thing. So we're keeping everything moving pretty well in our front desk. I've got to give kudos to Vicki. This year her project was to computerize our cash book. If you come into my office, I didn't want to carry it because it's as big as I am. I've got a ledger, it's about yay big. I'm not exaggerating in the least. It's a big red book, and it's basically our green ledger that has had our cash balances in it and our trial balances in it and our investments in it and how it's always been done. And this year she went to two Excel trainings here at the county, and she got those big books all on the computer, all in Excel. I now can go on and take a look at the cash book. I don't need to truck it back and forth in my office. Lori helps with the bank reconciliation on that. She too agrees it's a really nice improvement there. So we're moving towards getting everything technology, not only that, but we have it now backed up. Whereas before, those big red books, there's no backup. If the courthouse burns down, we've lost it. Well, now we've got it on electronic and it's backed up by the server. So it took her a while, but we got it down. Moving against electronics with the new bank system, we're still trying to keep those banking costs down. And we are going to have all the payroll transactions for employees as well as all the vendors, all electronic. It'll cut down on any additional banking fees by having the payroll moved over. And this may not sound like an improvement, but it really kind of is. Deanna didn't really have a backup for some of her knowledge and processes that she does. And she and I are working on making me her backup. If she were to be gone during some seasons, the other three are not backed up in there. They back up each other. And so we're working on getting Deanna a backup. And it's going to be a process. Most of the stuff that happens in my office happens once a year, maybe twice a year. And so we're it's nice to have a little bit of relief for Deanna on that part, and it's kind of nice for me, so then I know if she is having to be gone, I've got somebody that can step in and help out there. The other improvement was the new credit card process. Since we implemented it with a centralized billing that's approved by Becky, each month we have had no late fees. All the statements have been in and approved on time with all of the itemized receipts. So just that, it was a little bit of a stressful time the first couple of billing cycles, but I have to say everybody who has a card is pretty comfortable with the system now, and it works out very well. I think I probably can attest to that as well. Delegated in my office, actually I'm doing the reverse. I am undelegating some tasks. It seems that there are some things that were given to my staff that are better suited in a manager's position and are just better suited out of their realm of job description. And so I've only been in my office for a year. I have sat down with each and every one of my employees to kind of shadow them, find out what they're doing, when they're doing, when their busy season is, when they're stressed, when they're not stressed. And changing some processes has helped with reducing stress, as well as moving some of their tasks that they do to my office. Not only does that help me understand everything that goes on, but it also helps them to, they're able to provide more time for task force, provide more time for taxpayers, and it provides me more to do, actually.
Can you give an example of something like that?
Yes, I was a passport manager. That duty was assigned to Deanna, whenever my office had passports. Passport manager's job is to make sure that all of the passport agents, so everybody in the office has their annual training, make sure that all the forms are up to date, make sure that they're sufficient forms for that intake, making sure that any of the passport information that is passed on to us from the agency in Minneapolis is communicated well. If there's any updates, that they are also given to the passport agents. And then if they have any questions, they have a one point of contact for that. And it was given to Deanna, but like I said, that one is definitely more suited for a manager's position. Basically, because it is a tracking, and you have to make sure that everybody is qualified and certified, and I think that is a little bit more suited for the manager. We've worked with Deanna. She's very happy to toss that off, as she does have her hands full with a lot of the tax calc stuff. There are some investment things that Vicki was doing that I can do or was doing anyway during my investing. So then we're not doubling up, would be another example. So, but as I continue to learn what they are doing each and every day, then I can continue to analyze, what is this something that they should be doing? Is this something that could be better off in one of the other person's position, or is it better off in my office? So we're still learning, but the learning. That's pretty much how it is. And they're all very, very good. Each week they give me an update on what they've done, what they plan on doing. And so then I can say, oh, I'd like to learn that. And so I shadow them during that time. And a few other things that delegating, they're taking the financial statements away from the auditors. I'm sure they're not overly sad about that one, but that should help their audit costs if I can prepare those financial statements for them and then give them to the to audit rather than having them prepared. They get to the non-audit expense, so I should be able to do that and help out with that, as well as election training this year. Deb has traditionally done it, and election judge training. I will be going with Lori and Deb to training for that, and then I will be the one out handling the judges training rather than Deb. So that's another thing that I'll be fun delegating. continuing on with trying to keep everything moving, flowing, and advancing in the office, the lean process that I have started to look into, but we'll probably do a little bit more in depth when Becky makes me, is the accounts payable. It's not only a time-consuming process, but it's also kind of an expensive one if you think about it. We cut checks every week for auditor's warrants, and then twice a week when we cut auditor's and commissioner's warrants. We got to take a look at, you know, can that be reduced? Should it be every 2 weeks? Should it be every month? Should it be one auditor's warrants, one commissioner's warrants? There's a lot of timing things that need to be looked at, and we do have the technology within what we pay now to pay the vendors with an ACH push rather than an actual physical check. So that will be a click of a button and the vendors will be paid rather than cutting the checks, stamping them, stuffing them. So we have the cost of the envelopes, the mailing, and the time that it takes them to do all that. So there's another thing that we gotta take a look at, as well as the electronic approvals of invoices. Could it be better off scanned in, electronically approved, and then put in a type of system? And then we have the invoice electronically scanned in, who approved it, date that it was paid. And there are a couple of different programs out there that can do that for us. It will modernize us a little bit, and then everyone can go ahead and take a look at an invoice from their desk rather than having to come into the office and actually take a look at a paper file. So that is definitely a 2016 process that I want to take a look at and see what we can do to bring that a little bit closer to the 21st century here. As far as requests that I have for the board is not really a request, just more of a pain. Remember, statutes change, laws change, elections change. Just making sure to keep enough money in my training budget to make sure that we can keep myself and my staff up to date on those laws, and making sure that we've got all the technology that we need to make sure that those laws can be followed. And I do have the same concern that Jason does have. There's a few in my office that we've got retirement looming. There's a lot of knowledge that we'll be leaving in as long as we've got enough time for a new employee to be trained in by the old employee. That's going to be the easiest for training, and it's going to be the most effective way to turn over employees, just to make sure we've got enough time. 2 weeks is just not enough time when it comes to a year's worth of stuff they have covered. We don't have a very repetitive office. We have annual things that need to be done, and 2 weeks is going to give you hardly a breath of what one of my office workers do on a year-to-year basis. So just want to put that bug in your ear. To toot my own horn, as I think Aaron called it, I am very proud of the fact that on the 2014 audit, the findings, written and oral, both went down. The employee reimbursement requests, with the help of Becky, are now paid on a very timely basis, weekly, rather than can be a month or two in between their actual request and the check payment. And the credit card approval has not had a single late payment since we moved to the new system. So those are my really, I'm very proud of those specific three things. So I think I covered everything that you wanted, but I'm certainly open for questions.
I got a couple of questions. I think during the upcoming year, there'll be some absences due, you know, having maybe. And I guess to me, I would like to see a plan for how those duties will be carried out in the absence, just so that the board is communicated to about who their go-to and point people are on those and how duties will be delegated.
Yeah.
If that's important in the manager role. So I guess that's something that I would ask prior, maybe you come back to the board with prior to that absence and just talk about.
Yep, actually currently working with my staff. It is 4 months out, so we're trying to figure out timing and, you know, who is best to do what and what's going to be happening that we need to do that. We also have the audit that we need to consider. trying to see if we can't get that done before the end of March. We were able to get it pretty close to the end of March last year. If we know a little bit more, we should be able to get it done a little bit sooner. That should help as well, but there will be a plan, hoping to get that in place and work with all of my employees to make sure I've got delegates and working with Charlie to make sure that I got VPN access for the computer. So if I do need to be working from home, I've got full access to everything that I need, and my office workers are able to, you know, make requests of me if they don't know. So that there will be a plan probably at the end of January as far as how long, to who, and that sort of thing. So you all can be very comfortable with the leave of absence to which you are speaking.
The VPN, I think we need to look at a little bit more closely, because when you're dealing with financial records, I don't know if they're appropriate that they're dealt with without outside the courthouse. I think that's something I'd like to ask the auditors, because public work in a public place is, you know, the catchphrase, and I guess I want to have a comfort level that financial records should be accessed outside.
I can ask, absolutely.
And then I think too, you know, I want to say a few things. I think the audit was a really promising turnaround. I think there's been a lot of positive things made there. I feel like, I mean, I probably work closely with Amanda as elected official than I do the other elected officials. She's responsive to the things that I ask for. You know, the RFP, I asked her to look into that, and she did that this year and got that accomplished. Any process improvement things, you know, she's open to discussing and stuff. I do think, you know, your lean process on the AP, you had mentioned that. And to me, I'd like to see that occur sooner rather than later, which, you know, I was going to say, specifically because of that looming retirement this year, and I know she's pretty critical in that process. And I know there is a budgeted replacement. You know, the consultant that was in between yourself and the previous auditor indicated that there should be down one staff in that office. So if we can do that lean process, I think that would help us either justify or not justify that statement. So I don't want to say it necessarily shouldn't be replaced, but I think if we could do that lean process and say, no, it shouldn't, or yes, it should, that might support our decision and kind of either support or not support that what that individual said. You know, you were gone a lot this summer, and that office functioned without that additional staff, and that's my concern about replacing that person, is that the office functioned down one person. And so if Amanda was fully trained and that and some of those lean things were done, does there really justify a replacement? So I know that's in the budget, and when you approve it, you're approving the budget, but I would caution the board just to look at that and ask if the staffing level at that time is appropriate or not.
And her estimated retirement date isn't until, I believe, October 1st. So though we do have, you know, it's almost a full year of, there's a full year of her salary in the budget, so I don't think that decreasing the budget too much or if at all on the salary in that regard is that is appropriate at this time. But the other thing, it does make me a little bit concerned when we do go down within the accounting world. We have a segregation of duty issue. We always have with our audit. It's a written audit. It's guaranteed to be there, as we do have small staff. So it is a concern with me as far as, you know, segregation of duty, making sure that if we do go down, where are we going to, where are we going to limit that risk? And is there an additional process or approval that needs to be incorporated within the office if we do eliminate not replace? There is risks there, and just want to make sure that before we make that decision that we have a plan as far as to mitigate that risk.
I have none. I think you're doing a good job. Great job.
Thank you
for all you do.
I enjoy the work, so it makes it a lot easier. But we're done with the end of office. I do have a few things that need to be brought to your attention. There's just one set of warrants since the last time we've met. That would be November 18th. Just wanted to know if you had any questions on those.
Amanda, the $200 for Vicki Noonan. Usually it's paid on the commissioner's warrants. I'm just was wondering if it's coded properly to the ditch funds.
That's a retainer. Yes, it's properly coded on the on the ditch fund. Usually, the only reason why we put it on the commissioner's funds is the timing. He bills us generally for his time and for the retainer at the same time, so we just usually put it on one check. There wasn't any bills for the month of November, and so as it is a retainer and it's a contract already, we just put it on the auditor's warrants for the
timing purpose. From this point forward, it will be on the auditor's warrants?
The retainer can be, but like I said, it makes more sense to cut one check. If there is any additional billing, and with a couple different ditch items, it does tend to be more appropriate on the commissioner's warrants. But that is just the retainer, so.
I just had one on the court order attorney fees.
Well, they could be, sometimes there are certain things that the public defender's office doesn't cover, and then the court orders the county to pay that attorney for that thing, such as a commitment. Mm-hmm. Commitment hearings are not done through the public defender's office, so by statute, the county has to pay a designated fee for that attorney, and the 8th Judicial District sets that amount, which is, I think, $105 or $110 an hour for the work that they do. The judge orders that paid, and then we pay it.
And then sometimes there's a conflict of interest that we pay to another county? Not very often, but they then in turn pay us when you do conflict of interest cases?
Yes,
okay.
They do, they pay $110 an hour for the work that I do, and we pay them $110 an hour.
It's a seven figure.
Yeah.
So I have a question on that then. What fund does that come out of? Just the general
fund? That one does come out of the general fund, and it comes out of the countywide.
Okay.
Because here's a court order attorney fees for $1,271.
Yeah, Nan Agerty is one of the attorneys that, the way it works is these attorneys, they get on a list with the court, and they say they're willing to do these things, and then the court goes down the list, and we get Ken Hamrum, Nan Agerty, Jeff Kuhn, and they'll rotate through, and Nan's name probably came up, and she got appointed to a commitment or guardianship. And
did the work and got paid through the court?
Right.
So if the expense shows up through the general ledger, does the income then show up in the general ledger as well?
Different though. That has nothing to do with my office, the fee that you're talking about there.
No, but the conflict of interest.
I don't know where that goes.
That goes to yours because technically it's a bill from your office, so it's considered a revenue source for the county attorney.
His budget.
Thank you for answering that.
The other one goes into your countywide administrative court costs?
Yes.
Okay, so you can see right here in front of you, we're running at 77.82 for year to date. That was through the end of November. It's 10,000's budget. Who cares?
Well, it's good to know that we're
under
budget on that event, so.
We only got 1 month left to make it.
Were there any other questions in regards to the auditor's warrants? Okay, and then the final item that I need to speak to you about is you as a board are required to accept all donations per statute. And the donations are received by the youth activity fund. And since the last time you accepted the donations, which would be May 19th of 2015, there have been 3 donations that have been received. Bremer for $200, Woman of Today for $50, four. Common Cup for the amount of $500, and then a joint check, a personal check from Deb and Charlie for the amount of $50 that was deposited into the Youth Activity Fund. And I'm requesting that you approve the resolution to accept those 4 different donations for the Youth Activity Fund.
Move to approve.
Second.
A motion, a second, to approve the donations totaling $800 toward the Youth Activity Fund. Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Motion passed.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks, Amanda.
Explain it in the board packet. Hopefully, you could understand kind of what happened. It's a clerical error. It happened. It's the first time I've had to come to the board for abatement. So, usually, what happens if someone, if there's a problem, they'll pay the first half taxes and we can correct it before the second half. In this case, it was after the second half taxes. So, we just need your approval. It was approved by myself and Amanda. And we just need the board to approve it. It's just a clerical error. It just needs to be refunded back to the taxpayer.
So the refund is...
Sorry about it. It just happened and it's an error. So.
$3,060.
Yes.
Okay. I'll move for the abatement of $3,060. James Carter.
I'll second. Got a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign.
I think that he needs to sign. Does he need to sign something on the abatement? Do you have the abatement with you? The abatement, okay. Does he need to sign something on there, or do you just need to
sign? I just need to sign it. He has already.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so that's
what
I have.
What's that?
Don't let it happen again.
I know.
I can promise you he will not.
That's pretty bad that he didn't even know.
That's my doing and not her.
Yeah, that's...
We're doing everything by the book.
Thank you, Judy.
Yeah. Pardon me, Amanda. We're trying.
We're doing our best.
When I had the county update, I didn't necessarily have all the positions. I had Jan to summarize them, but I wanted to give you guys an update on those. Okay. So starting at the top, we have a lot of moving parts right now because of the open positions that are open, and you know. You've heard me say this before, but there's a critical lack of leadership of skilled people, and it's pronounced in rural areas. So we've gotten some good candidate pools, but it's been difficult to staff some of the positions that we have open. The 2 social worker positions that we've been looking for quite a while. We have one that will start December 8th, that's Marissa Stevenson. She will have an anticipated caseload of child protection. They're going to do some caseload shifting down there, and that's so the new person will fall into that child protection caseload. We offered for the second position, but the applicant declined the offer. We're holding off on staffing that second position to consider our options. We didn't feel like the pool that we had was sufficient for the workload that person was going to have. They didn't have the right experience.
So do we have a reason why she declined?
I believe it's, you know, due to partially wage and then just, you know, timing and other opportunities.
Okay.
It's not that I feel like we should go up and...
That's what I was wondering, if it was all...
I don't feel like we should, you know, if you start... The union positions, when they're based upon a union contract and their wage scale, it's difficult to negotiate because it really upsets your current structure of your workforce. And so... You know, it's different if you have somebody coming in maybe with 15, 20 years of experience. You can justify it to that staff to bring them in up higher, but it wasn't that case this time.
Thank you.
Yeah. The eligibility worker has been a nightmare, and, you know, it's interesting because this is the entry-level position. Our applicant pool, we actually had about 14 in the applicant pool, and I think only 6 passed the test. We've never had that happen before. We've had maybe one or two not pass in the applicant pool, but the over half of them did not pass the eligibility, the merit system test. So once we got that done, we interviewed the candidates. The one that we were going to make the offer to withdrew because they accepted another position. Then we offered the position to the second applicant and they declined for financial reasons. But again, we had just brought eligibility workers in at step one this year, and we just felt like we couldn't negotiate. That person had no prior eligibility worker experience, and so we just held firm that all we could offer was at step one, and they just declined. The two additional applicants, one we did some reference checks on and they weren't favorable. And so we went back to the merit system list. Merit system is very difficult to deal with. I'd like to not be a part of that because they don't give us consistent information. So it's one of the things Jan and I are going to work on in 16 is meeting with them and finding out why we're not getting consistent information. There were other eligible candidates that were on the list that weren't sent to us the first time. So we are going to interview both of them because they both were interested and they were both qualified. So that's going to happen on December 4th. The social services supervisor, there was four applicants. The hiring decision we made this week, we were waiting for that testing to come back. We've been doing that testing through the Minnesota Workforce Center, and I was telling the personnel committee and all related to the full board that is a very, very important tool. You know, they've gone from providing it free to a $40 fee, but this is a test that you pay $400, $500, $600 in the private industry to have access to, and it reads like a book. You see, what you see in the interview is relaying itself right in that test. So I think it's important to wait for that, and that's going to impact that hiring decision. The deputy sheriff criminal investigator closed on the 30th. Five applications, and actually they're, I don't know how many they were scoring right before this. They're going to try to interview them Friday morning. I'd like to get these all cleaned up before the end of the year so we can start fresh in January. Human Services Director, we did review applicants. There were six of them, two which were internal. We reviewed them today. There's a recommendation that we'll review three of those on Friday, December 4th, and then I would like to set a time to bring the final candidates in front of the full board, and maybe we can set that date today. I'd like to get that done as soon as possible. Not as big of a pool as I would like to see, but I really struggle with recommending opening this up. I'd like to get through the interviews and do the testing. We could spend another $3,200 and not increase our pool at all. And, you know, there's some human service agencies that have been looking for directors for a year. And I do feel the way a few of the applicants scored that we've got a good pool enough to make it, you know, to move forward. Other news. We had, the open enrollment was really successful. As of yesterday morning, we only had five applicants that hadn't turned in a waiver or signed up for open enrollment. And at the end of yesterday, we had 33 enrolled in the PEEP plan. So that's really fantastic. I projected 32. PEEP's at 40, but I'm very happy with what we got for participation. The feedback from the individuals that were enrolling in it, we're thankful to have a good option for health insurance this coming year. LELS and AFSCME General have voted to approve the two-year contract and highly meet next week. So we'll be bringing those tentative agreement or those agreements to sign to the board on the 16th.
I'd like to thank Becky and our personnel committee for hammering those out. I know it's a very difficult process. And you guys get kudos. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. It's a two-year, 2%. Nobody's got a reopener except for, LELS took a reopener clause for next year just to review the health insurance because it was a two-year contract with PEEP. It was difficult. We had a lot of things outstanding. The union started high. One of the unions wanted 4%. We ultimately settled on 2%. The big contentious issue was health insurance and what was going to happen with that. And so we worked through those issues, and I'm very, very thankful to have a two-year contract and not have to go back into this next September. So.
There was some things other things we wanted, but we didn't get.
Yeah. There was, there was a lot of cleanup language in the contracts there was an inconsistency between county policy and the way the contract read. So different, you had non-union and union employees that are being held to different standards, and I still want that resolved. Some of those things, you know, a lot of the cleanup language, we got some concessions on FMLA, and there was a clause in there that, you know, oral reprimands could go to file. Well, to me, if you're not putting your, we're putting the oral reprimands in file, so we weren't following it, but you have to, because that's a part of that permanent record. And if you're proving corrective discipline in terms of progressive discipline towards termination or performance improvement, that's a vital piece of that. So we got some concessions and things like that. Some of the overtime after shifts and things I'll probably never get, but I'll keep asking for it every year. Because to me, I feel like if you have union hourly employees, there should be a similar threshold with similarly situated employees.
We should thank Janet Ragoose too, because I know she did a lot of the scheduling.
Yeah.
Kind of a nightmare thing, so.
So I'll put that, let's see, what else am I going to tell you? Todd mentioned Jackson County. We are going to go down there and tour that facility this Thursday. You know, just trying to keep in mind potential for a possible upgrade or replacement for the highway. We want to see some of the things that they did there. I don't think there's a lot of people aren't in the right position to partner with us on that facility, other county, other cities and things like that right now. It's just not the right timing for that to work out. But we'd like to go down there and look at that facility. Open enrollment, we talked about that. What else do I have?
AMC's coming up.
AMC is, we leave Sunday at 3, right? No.
3, because we're going to meet, my meeting's at 5.
Sunday at 3, I have a van. If anybody's going to go with, just let me know. We can meet out at the highway at 3. There is, it's a full day on Tuesday. We just looked at that this morning, but it, you know, it doesn't look like we'll be out of there until between 2 and 3 on Tuesday. There is a petition outstanding for unit clarification on AFSCME. There are 4 positions that the union asked to be included. This was about the same time we did the wage study. Due to the change in Minnesota Data Privacy and Protection Act definition for confidential employees, one of the 4 positions we did not contest, so we said, yep, you can put them in the union. That person started when they had started employment. The other 3 positions we contested because one of them is the payroll. And to me, I feel like they know, they're privy to union sensitive information prior to the contract being settled. So to me, that is critical when it comes to that relationship. The other is the, you know, the accountant for the highway garage. And again, she was really instrumental in helping me. She did a lot of stuff for me, similar to what she did for Brian, you know, previously, and put information in, and she knew what some of the wage COLA things were that we were negotiating. The other position is IT support position. And again, to me, I think they have, because of our small department, they have system-wide access to everything. So they're privy to private information on other employees, and it's very difficult. So we're gonna contest that. We did contest it, we thought it went away after the union contracts were voted on. He did inform us that he did petition the Bureau of Mediation Services to make a ruling on that. Their response was that they were going to wait for a test case. There's only been 10 similar cases in the last 4 years. That so to wait for a test case is basically saying we're in no hurry to resolve it. So he has petitioned for a conference call, and I will keep you up to date on those. I still feel like the 3 positions that we contested really justifiably have access to confidential information during union negotiation periods. So I'll let you know what happens with that.
Get the membership?
Yes.
Yep.
Wait a minute. You need a motion to approve Marissa's hire?
I don't know why I shouldn't have that on here. I don't have the wage and grade.
I'll move to approve.
Okay.
Second.
Yeah, because we didn't do that the previous.
No, we didn't.
I'll second. Got a motion to second to approve Marissa Stevenson's hire. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Motion passed.
Okay, thank you. I have the county membership dues for NACO in the amount of $450 per furlough.
Is that changed?
No. believe that was, really quick, I thought that's what it was last year. They're barely in,
That's all right. I just.
No, I do not believe there is an increase because I went back and looked at it. I don't like how we have this in the budget. We have it by one line item for dues and it's not broke out, so you're not able to track it. And you have to go back and actually pull a manual invoice every time you want to find out or rely on your memory. So that's one thing Amanda and I might work on is maybe, and I know you don't want 1,000 codes, but it would be nice to have NACO dues and you can track them from year to year and you can, you know, pull it. But anyways, it's more information than you asked for.
So we need a motion for that?
Yeah.
A motion and a second?
Second.
Motion and a second to pay NACO $450 for dues. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign, motion passes.
NACO.
2016 MACO dues.
MACO, NACO, CAFCO,
yeah,
MACA.
That's $900.
That is, and I do not know if that is an increase or not. I believe this is the same thing as my MACA dues. How they set it is based on like your county size and your percentage of, they figure out the budget and then they back it out and say you're this percentage of it. So.
Got a motion, need a second?
Okay.
Motion and a second to get a membership, renew the membership dues of $900 to make it. Further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion passed. And resolution opposing the creation of the Minnesota Red River Basin.
I did get one more, unless you want to do one more approval for Lakes County
sure.
Service Cooperative. I just received that this week after this
okay.
one out. In Coles, please sign the renewal membership agreement for the calendar year, so we're renewing our membership. Fees remain the same. At $75 plus $3 per full-time employee, so it's a max up to $250. So those are staying the same. So that would be for the 2016 year for $250.
Move to approve.
I'll second that. Motion and second to approve that. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign.
And then when you're done, I'm going to pass you out a ballot. There is an election for Lakes Country Service Cooperative. And then if you want to just give it back to me for their board. So I'll pass it out at the end of the meeting. Okay, then we have the resolution for the opposition of the Minnesota River Basin. That is a resolution that has been passed in numerous counties. I don't know if anybody wants to go into.
We have it.
You've got
yeah.
it all right here,
yeah.
right?
We
so you got a chance to read that?
Yep.
No,
I was going to ask you.
Candy, Ojai County. They didn't have enough support to pass it at their last meeting.
Really?
Yes. Opposing it.
Huh.
And you know more about this because weren't you part of it? Or?
I was, yeah.
So
I guess.
I think you've heard your speech.
So the Chippewa River, they voted this resolution in place too. And a lot of the counties are, but then it was brought up at the AMC district meeting. Down in, I don't know where they had their meeting, down south. But they wanted to pass a resolution in support of it. So there's
two sides. Two,
yeah. And I guess I just read an article. This Minnesota River Congress has been meeting. They met in November, and they're the ones that are. They've actually started a group called Minnesota River Congress, and they're filing for a 501c3 status with the Secretary of State now. So they're going to be an official organization, and they're the ones pushing forward with this bill to form Minnesota River Basin, is what they're going to call it.
How do you get money from the legislature, right?
Well, I think the bill, I think if you read the bill, there's $500,000 in the bill to establish this. But their ultimate goal is to get levying authority, and basically what they're trying to do is copy the Red River Basin Commission and, you know, do projects through that. But the smaller watersheds, they feel that they're already doing the projects, and that it would be actually doubling up the funding. They'd actually take funding away from the, like, the Pommy Terror and the Chippewa River and all the smaller watersheds for that. And they feel that they're doing as much as they can with the funds that they have to help improve the Minnesota River. So yeah, if you want to, you go to the Minnesota River Congress. They're having a meeting, I think, in February again. I'm not sure. They haven't set the date yet.
Good advice.
But I would make a motion to accept that resolution.
I'll second it. Got a motion and a second to accept the resolution opposing the creation of Minnesota Red River Basin Commission.
Not Red River.
Minnesota River.
Minnesota, I'm sorry. Yeah. Minnesota River. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, same sign. Motion passes.
I guess we have enough time. I should just give you guys a brief update on department head reviews. We have time for that.
Sure.
Do you want to do that? No? Okay. I am completed with all the department head reviews except for Janet's. Janet's is scheduled on the day open enrollment close, which was poor planning on my part. So through no fault of her own, but we just had constant people coming in the door. Overall, I think the reviews went really positive. I have, I feel like I have a good working relationship with all the department heads. I did not do a review with Joni. She's retiring in just a few weeks, and so I didn't do one with that position. I did one with every other position. I did work through and set goals. I want each of them to take a lean process in their office and address it this year and try to give some time savings, people savings, money savings. And so what I think I will do is I'll summarize those all and include those in the 12-16 board packet with a tentative schedule. If there's any of those processes you guys want to sit through, you're more than welcome to if there's an area that's of interest to you. You know, I think I did not do facilities. That is up to Donnie and Ron to do. But the other ones that I sat through, you know, some of the things really overall very good. Environmental services and planning and zoning, you know, responded very well to taking additional workload on this year. They took GIS and really were able to help push that integration with other county offices. I think that was a good outcome from 2015. Assessor's office, you know, one of the things I appreciate about Judy is her knowledge. She's been here so long, and every time I have a question, she's able to answer it. If there's things that she knows I'm going to need to know about, she makes sure that she stays in contact. She's got a well-run office. The gals there, you know, are very, they have a good working relationship, and she has no outstanding performance issues with any of them. It's just well-ran. One of the things in her budget for 2016 was when they lose Don with the contract, is instead to hire that person. And I think that's probably one of the goals that we're going to set for that integration, is how that integrates with the office. And she showed me some statistics, you know, 40% of the people that hold accreditation licenses are anticipated not to renew them in 2016 and 2017 because of the accreditation legislation that went through. And she anticipates that more of the local taxing districts will push that or ask for that, you know, to be taken the workload at the county level. So I think that, you know, that position that's in the budget will be half funded through city assessing contract. And so maybe we can get some additional funding and mentor that person into a role for a county assessor level. The other thing that she and I talked about was to, you know, finish integrating some of the computer, the CAMA stuff, and that she knows is critical and is coming and would like to push that to whoever hires for that position. Hopefully they have, you know, some technological background in that area. Let's see. Charlie, we visited with him about IT. There's some, you know, different projects he wants to look at doing this year to streamline. He has identified some things in 2015, you know, that there was some, there was a lot of open phone lines. I mean, there's a lot of things that hadn't gotten eliminated for whatever reason, and saved about, you know, about $60,000+. So I think that's a significant amount of money. There's open phone lines, there was some Wi-Fi hotspots and stuff that weren't being paid, and I think he's got a real attention to that. You know, I think in that position was new for him when Scott left, and so just working on developing his professionalism and things like that, and working in that manager role is a challenge. But overall, I've worked with talked to Todd a little bit. We talked about some things that they can do there. He's still working on something to identify to give me a process for improvement. He and I talked, you know, he said one of the things that he was concerned about taking the position was all the budgeting responsibility. He kind of took a team approach this year, and I think that was fine to use the resources he had. That's one goal he kind of set for himself as we were talking, is to continue to be involved and get educated about that process. I think the thing that I like about Todd is he's very empathetic, you know, with consumers and or constituents. He really makes an effort to get out and inform people of some of the things that are coming up, and I really appreciate that about him. His, you know, the staff have well liked and well received by him, so, you know, a good review there. What am I missing? I do need, we are going to do, there's, you know, Jan, we share that with the three of us. So I'll do Janet's review. I'll summarize all the goals that each department set, and I'll email those, or I'll send them with the packet the next time. I'll do Janet's, and we'll do Jan's the 10th of December, and then Nancy's on my list. And I met with Extension today just to find out a little bit more of what they did. The regional director was there and stuff, and that was really a good learning relationship for me. I think that there's some, you know, with having a SNAP educator on staff and things, there's some interagency building that we can do, you know, between that person and human services as the year comes. And so we'll try to get them maybe utilizing those resources some more too, because I think there's some certain some opportunities since Ash has been hired. Let's see, what else? It was a busy last couple of weeks. That's why you didn't hear from me, Bob. I was doing all my reviews. But I do think it's important, you know, when I talked about strategic planning, when I talked about all these lean processes, I think that's something that if in the first quarter, as a board, we could do a strategic planning day and talk about some staffing levels, talk about some goals, and then some lean processes, follow those up in the second quarter with those lean things, and then just, I think that strategic planning kind of needs to come before that lean process does, and I would certainly like your guys' participation in that. So.
You mentioned you didn't do a review for Joni. Will you do like an exit interview?
Yeah, and that's what I thought was more appropriate. Thank you, Jeannie. We implemented that, you know, I asked Janet to do that, implement an exit in an onboarding process, and so she is going to do that. It was more to me, the performance review was this year and then looking into next year, and that, you know, wasn't really appropriate. And then I think there's some strategic things, goals too, you know, for the new director coming on that I'd like to set, and I think I'll do a meeting when that person comes on board too and go from there. Some of the other things, you know, that we're gonna do that are interdepartmental would be like the auditing on the computer access. That was something that was brought up on the audit. And so when somebody's set up as a user, there's not a formal approval process. You know, CPUI can set up a user in the system, but as well as Amanda, but there's no formal paper trail. So if you don't have a paper trail for approving access, you're not ever auditing it either. And so that is something that is on our list to do in 16. Amanda and I have talked about that quite a bit, and Charlie as well, because I mean it comes into an IT aspect as too. There's some building security issues. You know, there's badges, keys, and fobs that are assigned. ID badges, and that process isn't flowing smoothly, nor is it uniform across departments. So those are some processes we're going to pull interdepartments together and work on as well. So that's all I got. The lights went out as I was finishing.
Yeah. And I was just wondering, is the door unlocked?
You know, I was just thinking that. I think we should call dispatch as soon as we're done.
I'm going to
And just remind, and just ask that it be unlocked for a TNT.
Do we adjourn, or do we...
Oh, Commissioner Sanchez?
Yes.
Adjourn.
Adjourn, then I have to call the meeting order. So, that a motion, second?
Yep.
Motion second to adjourn. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
With opposed, same sign. We're adjourned.